for some of you, your lunch hour, I'm sure, to come and learn a little bit about women's body image and how it is impacted on collegiate campuses. My name is Jamie Workman. I'm a coordinator of residence life at Miami University. I've been here for 3 years, and I'm also currently enrolled in a PhD program at Ohio University in their higher ed program. And my research interests all focus around body image and eating disorders, specifically the women's aspect of those topics, and specifically looking at how a residential life experience or a residence hall residential living experience can impact a woman's body image either negatively or positively. So this is a presentation I've done at a regional housing officer conference in the past, so this is the first time I've ever done the web version of it, so bear with me a little bit. I'm going to try not to talk too much so you don't have to listen to me babble for half an hour. But what we're going to do is use a little bit of our technology, our friends at YouTube and things like that, hopefully to make this presentation as interactive as it can be and fun. At the end of the session, there'll definitely be some time for those of you who have questions or comments to chime in via Twitter or however else you're going to do that. So we definitely want to save some time for that at the end. All right, just wanted to show everybody a little bit about the learning objectives of this session. I don't want to go into them in too much detail, but you can take a look at some of the things that I'm hoping we'll gain with our time together this afternoon. So there you go. And wanted to open up the session kind of by talking a little bit about some of the facts and statistical knowledge that I've gained and some of the research that I've done. I want folks to know that I haven't done any major hardcore research by any means on this, but have done a little bit here and there for different sessions. And actually ran across a really good little PowerPoint thing on YouTube, which I'm going to try to open up right now. Hopefully you all are going to be able to see it. And there is, ooh, there we go. General population. And as you can tell, a lot of this really carries into women as they develop, not only through elementary school, high school, but certainly carrying on to them as they go into college. So a lot of people are coming in with a little bit of baggage in terms of, you know, who they are and how they feel about their body. And we'll talk a little bit more about media and some other influences and things that really impact college women a little later in the session. But just wanted to give you all a little bit of information about the general population and then focus a little bit more on the research I've done regarding college women. So during college, we're taught to analyze and scrutinize everything we read and see, and we apply our newly honed skills to ourselves. I thought that was a really interesting fact. You know, thinking about what we're doing in the classroom, we're told to pick things apart, told to look at things from a lot of different perspectives and really be analytical about things, and then thinking about how we're using those skills to actually harm ourselves in some cases, what women are looking at in terms of their body. I never had made that connection until recently, and I thought it was really interesting. Body and self-criticism are well-practiced rituals for a large number of college women. We bond over dieting together, compared pinch inches of fat and putting ourselves and our appearance down. In this way, we reinforce each other's insecurities about our body. This is actually from one of the books I used in the reference that was written in the voice of a college woman, obviously. And, you know, when we think about that, those type of things, I think we can see them every day on our college campuses. I know as a member of a residential life staff, I eat my lunch meals on campus in a residence hall, and we'll see what women are talking about and see, you know, what's on their plates and overhear some of the discussions that they're having regarding those food choices. And I think some of it is it's pretty negative, and it's a little scary sometimes to think about how concerned a lot of the women that I see on my campus are about over what they're eating and what's going into their body and how they're treating their bodies. 91% of recently surveyed women on college campuses had controlled their weight through dieting, and 22% dieted often or always. And there's certainly something to say about dieting. I don't want to come across that I am anti-dieting by any means, but I think one of the challenges is a lot of people don't know how to do it properly. So those are things sometimes that we try to teach is how to make good choices, you know, how to work with your health center or any other services you may have on your campus to make sure that if you are going into a diet or weight control program that you're doing one that's going to be healthy for you, because a lot of times people will kind of throw themselves into one and don't quite know what they're getting into, and they won't do it the proper way. A lot of the focus of the original research I did on this presentation was talking a little bit about media. And as I've kind of dug into this over the past couple of months, you know, some of the things that you see are really scary. We think about, you know, some of the websites that folks are going on right now, you know, the Pred Hilton, TMZ, the Skinny Bitch website and Celeb Bitchy are basically just posting pictures, and you can see Lindsay Lohan and Rihanna, and then over to the left of the screen are the stars from the new 90210, and we'll actually talk a little bit more about those ladies later. Those are basically just websites that you post skinny celebrity pictures, and so women can comment and talk about them. Women or men can comment and talk about what they think about those pictures. And, you know, there's a lot of praise. There's a lot of praise for some of those stars. And, you know, I would look at Lindsay's picture right now and say that she is underweight and probably isn't the healthiest she's ever been in her life. Somebody else might think a little bit differently about that picture. But it's definitely something for us to think about, you know, how some of our students are spending some of their social time going on these websites, you know, popping on them between classes and maybe chatting about them on their Facebook or whatever. It really puts an interesting spin on how the media is impacting, you know, the ideal concept of what a woman is and what health is and what, you know, positive body image is. A little bit more about the media, thinking about, you know, what magazines and other publicity can do with them. And these pictures are actually held over from my last time I did this session, so they're not super old, or they're not super new, but I did want to keep them in because I thought they were really interesting. The People magazine with Jennifer Love Hewitt was from about a year ago, maybe a little over a year ago, talking about the issue with her in her bikini. You know, stop calling me fat is what the title says, and her celebrating her body and being okay with the fact that she was a little bit more curvy than maybe she had been in the past. And then turning around, just the Us magazine came out just a couple of months later. It said Jennifer Love Hewitt reveals her new thin body, and there she is celebrating a loss of 18 pounds, which I think is interesting that only happened a few months apart. You know, one, stop calling me fat, but then I'm going to turn around and lose 18 pounds and show up on another magazine smiling and proud of my progress. Which certainly, if that's what Jennifer needed to do to be happy and to be healthy, let's go ahead and do it, but let's make sure that she is doing that properly and taking the time that she needed to make good choices. I wanted to include the Cheryl Burke images in this presentation. Cheryl Burke is one of the dancers on Dancing with the Stars, and she's actually paired up with one of our Cincinnati favorites, Chad Ochocinco, right now. So they are talking about her every morning on my radio show, talking about how she's doing in her weight loss, weight gain has been a pretty hot topic for those of you who are following Dancing with the Stars. And I actually personally don't, but my family does, so I'm always hearing about Cheryl Burke and the other dancers. Wanted to turn it back over to the great resource of YouTube just to kind of see some other things. Again, These are things very common. Our students are watching on TV, wanting to show that both the negative and the positive. So I'm going to flip over to a more negative media clip, which some of you might recognize if you happen to watch ABC on Sunday evenings.
Juanita, this dress is awfully tight. I don't think you can get into it.
No, it's pretty. I can do it.
How'd that one fit? Oh, I think we're going to need the next size up. there is no next size up. They don't make princess dresses for girls over 7. She's only 4 and a half. Oh. Wow. Look, my daughter was invited to a princess party, so I can't let her be the only girl there without a princess dress. Did you try the costume section? I bet they'd have a Mrs. Shrek dress that would fit her.
Want me to take off the dress? We're going.
No, I can do it.
Look, I feel for you. My niece also has a weight problem. My daughter does not have a weight problem.
She has a little baby fat, that's all. In fact, the only problem she has is this store being completely unprepared for a perfectly average 4-year-old girl.
Mijita, lunch is ready. Go get your sister.
Carlos, what's with all the cheese?
You know how Juanita feels about Brussels sprouts. I'm just trying to make vegetables more fun.
Well, next time, give her a carrot and put her on a roller coaster. Have you tried to lift her lately?
I know she's gotten chubby. She'll grow out of it.
We can only hope with your DNA running through her veins.
Hey, I do not have fat DNA.
Oh, don't make me pull out the Solis family photo album. It's like a bunch of sea lions posing on a rock.
Oh, I'm sorry my relatives don't measure up to the group of thick, thin drunks that you come from.
All I'm saying is that our daughter has a weight problem, and the sooner we admit it, the better.
She's only 4. But, you know, you want her to develop a weight problem? Go ahead, nag, criticize, make her feel self-conscious. See what happens.
All right. Oh, sorry. Stop. I hope everybody could hear that. All right, I am going to try to turn the volume up a little bit for the next clip. But for those of you who may not be Desperate Housewives fans, Gabby, who's the mother in the scene, was a former model on the show. She was a model in her youth. And this is a flash forward that had happened. They started last season, 5 years in advance. So these are the first time we're meeting the Solis children. And talking about, you know, her concerns and the parents' concerns with Juanita's weight, and she's 4 and a half is what Gabby says. So certainly a lot of these images and a lot of these concerns start really early in a child's life. I don't think, you know, what Gabby was experiencing with her daughter was atypical. You know, I think that her thoughts came from love and concern, obviously, but some of the messages that she was sending were pretty negative. And pretty disturbing, I would say. Desperate Housewives has done some really interesting things, if you follow the show, kind of talking about Gabby's transformation as a mother, and they ended up having her lose some weight over the course of last season, and talking about how the daughters are adjusting to life, and they've pulled some different things in with their weight over the last couple of seasons, and it's been really interesting. Wanted to flip the coin a little bit and talk, do something a little bit more on the positive end. I know some of us may or may not be Tyra Banks fans, and this clip may be a little familiar to some folks, but wanted to go ahead and play it. And again, I hope this is working out for all of you.
The bottom line is that people are used to seeing me looking like this and like this and all that. And everyone seems to be pretty okay with that. But for some reason, people have a serious problem when I look like that. All right? When I look like that. But luckily, I'm strong enough and I have a good support system. I mean, I love my mama. She has helped me to be a strong woman so I can overcome these kind of attacks. But if I had lower self-esteem, I would probably be starving myself right now. That's exactly what is happening to other women all over this country. So I have something to say. To all of you that have something nasty to say about me or other women that are built like me, women that sometimes or all the time look like this, women whose names you know, women whose names you don't, women who've been picked on, women whose husbands put them down, women at work or girls in school, I have one thing to say to you. Kiss my fat ass.
All right. Let me get this turned off. And thank you, Tyra, for that little bit of inspiration. Seeing that clip, and actually a friend of mine had directed me to that clip last year when I was kind of putting this original presentation together, because I don't watch the Tyra Banks show because I work, and it's on when I'm at work, so I don't see it on a regular basis. But it really spoke to me as someone, and I personally identify as someone who is overweight and has struggled with my weight and my body image for a long time. Also, I think what Tyra had to say about husbands who put down their wives, that spoke to me a lot as well because I grew up in a household where that was pretty prevalent. My mother has also struggled with weight for quite a bit of her life, and it was very common for my father to make negative comments towards the both of us about that. So thinking about how those things have impacted me as an adult woman dealing with her own body image and working with college students, primarily college women today, who may be experiencing some of the same things, I think it's really interesting to think about how, you know, the media plays into that. And, you know, what are we seeing? Are we watching more of the Desperate Housewives type clips, or are we seeing more of the Tyra Banks speaking out? One last clip, and I promise I will get away from YouTube here in a minute. But one of the most interesting things I found as I was updating the research for this presentation, a few years ago I was looking into anorexia and bulimia, specifically women who were suffering from those eating disorders, and had kind of learned about the web community around those disorders and people creating what they would call pro-Anna or pro-Mia websites, pro-Anna being pro-anorexic and pro-Mia being pro-bulimic websites. And there was, you know, these communities that were created primarily for young women, and I would say more high school, maybe, you know, 19, 20 at the max and younger, where these websites were targeting. Also, a lot of them were in Europe, as I discovered, which I thought was really interesting. A lot of them have been pulled down, but very interesting enough, as I was playing around on YouTube looking for some stuff, I ran across this fine clip. And I'm not going to play the whole thing. Pretty long.
Everything is not as it feels. But the more I grow, the less I know. And I have lived so many lives.
All right, and that pretty much just continues as it is, basically a slideshow. Showing pictures of the stars from the new 90210, which I will admit I follow. I love it. I grew up with the old 90210, so I am a diehard fan, although I would say it's probably not as good as it was in the 80s. But these stars have gone under a lot of scrutiny over the past couple of years about their size and their bodies and things like that. I thought it was really interesting to run across this PowerPoint. You'll notice the author, the woman who posted it, her name is Liz Anna Mia, which to me may be connected to the pro-Anna and pro-Mia websites that I talked about a few minutes ago. I would guess that is a screen name. And then looking at some of the comments, you know, they look great. They are also gorgeous. And then, you know, some of the more negative things as you scroll down. Come on, get real, no one in school ever looks like that kind of thing. And even though this show is targeted for high schoolers, they're in high school in the show, a lot of college students are watching it, particularly a lot of women. So, you know, they're seeing some of these messages, and, you know, they might be checking out these YouTube clips, I'm not sure. But I think it puts in a really interesting kind of perspective to think about, okay, who are our role models? And even though these role models are younger, pretty much, than our traditional college women, they're still what our women are aspiring to be. And how are they going to be able to do that when a lot of what they're watching and what they're talking about is high school or even younger sometimes. So I thought that was really interesting, and, you know, wasn't quite sure what Miss Liz Anna Mia's thought was on this, and I also found it really interesting that she had, you know, the info on eating disorders right here and the ads that were running during the actual clip. You know, what does that mean for her and what motivated her to post this video? So a little interesting thing I kind of stumbled upon in my research. But obviously there's good stuff out there. You know, wanted to cite some pictures of some things that, you know, are fairly recent, not super new, out there that are good and that promote healthy choices and healthy body image. I'm going to save all the discussion kind of towards the end since we're doing a web version of this. I think it'll be a little easier, so I'm going to pop over to another thing that I found is really kind of key would be, you know, the actual people, you know, not just who they're talking to on the internet or what they're watching on TV, but the people in our women's lives. You know, those being family, peers, and campus environment. Want to talk a little bit about the residential environment, so we'll do that here in just a few minutes. But, you know, thinking specifically of my campus, Miami University, there is definitely an image of what it means to be a Miami student, and very specifically what it means to be a Miami girl. And if I get a picture of a Miami girl in my head, I am thinking of someone who is very thin, very attractive, probably Caucasian, probably from an affluent community, well-dressed, you know, high-end clothes, high-end shoes, that kind of thing. And so what does that mean for us as we think about those stereotypes? And we all probably have them. We have the, you know, what is the University of Arizona student? What is the Eastern Illinois University student? What is any other campus that might be out there student mean? And there's always that stereotype. And you know, maybe it definitely shifts from campus to campus, but there is an image that's associated with being part of any respective campus. And how do you support your students that may not fall into that block? And how do you support those students that do and help them make sure that they're making healthy choices? You know, particularly thinking about, we look at the little girl here on the scale, you know, she's just a little, maybe a two-year-old. And I think that ties into some of the things that we saw Gabby talking about with her daughter, or we saw Tyra referencing about her father, or the husbands that she referenced. So some really interesting things as we think about, you know, what our students are coming into. Oops, just clicked ahead. That's all right. What our students are coming in with, kind of some of, and I don't want to say baggage, but I can't think of a better term right now, some of the baggage that they're experiencing, and how do we as student affairs and higher education professionals help them. Wanted to kind of think about some resources that we have, you know, making sure that you're aware of campus resources for all of your students, not just your women, but making sure that they're aware. You know, some campuses will do programmatic response. Our HOCs right here are our campus, our peer health educators, health advocates for wellness, knowledge, and skills, because we're the Red Hawks here at Miami. Anything that you're doing on the residential level, because, again, my focus is residential life and the residential experience. But there's a lot of stuff out there, and I think we just need to make sure that you're getting students to seek out those resources. And again, my list is pretty limited, but there's certainly a lot of things going on a lot of different campuses. What I wanted to do now is kind of open up the floor, per se, the virtual floor, for questions and discussion. And I understand that Jeff and Gary are going to kind of help field that with me. So Jeff and Gary, if you have questions out there, or audience folks, if you have questions, get them typed in, and I will do my best to respond to them.
Yes, and to ask questions, there's a chat box on your on the little GoToWebinar software, so you can type the question in there. Also, if you're on Twitter, you can type in your message on Twitter and just do the hashtag or pound sign big drink, and we'll get that question off. So, speaking of Twitter, Gary's been watching that. Are there any questions from Twitter, Gary?
There just some general comments going on Twitter. Lynn Ellison mentions that it's not just women anymore, and that she once had a fascinating class discussion with guys who felt they didn't fit in on campus.
Mm-hmm. I think I agree 100%, and sorry to come across as if it wasn't just a women's issue, because I know it's definitely not. Again, my research has been focused on women just because, you know, when you're planning long-term research, you have to keep narrowing and narrowing your scope, but Right. Certainly, it continues to be prevalent and more prevalent in our men's population. I think specifically about the men on my campus. You know, there is what it means to be a Miami man just as much as there is what it means to be a Miami woman. So that's really interesting. I do some collateral work for our division in our Women's Center, and we have a student affairs and higher education graduate student doing some practicum work over there. And the work that he's doing is kind of, they collaborate with our GLBT resource coordinator in looking at body image and eating disorder prevalence in the gay men's community. And so there's been some really interesting stuff he's been able to do some research on that I hadn't really got into personally, and look for good things to come in terms of research in that area.
Yeah, and Grace Fama also mentions that he's interested to see what kind of research is going to be out there about male body image, because he sees more men on campus obsessing over their body now than he used to.
Absolutely.
Jamie, how do you balance programs around eating disorders or body image juxtaposed to talking about wellness? And to talk about wellness without and still being positive on body image?
Absolutely. And I think thinking about what we're doing in my department and on my campus, I think that there is a lot of overlap. And sometimes, at least here, it's hard to not talk about one without the other, because you think about how much taking good care of yourself and feeling positive about yourself affects your overall health and wellness. You know, we can talk about the emotional strain that negative body image can have on a person, and also the physical strain it can have on a person. You know, thinking about folks who, you know, might use the rec center excessively. We have a concern with that, with a lot of our students going to the rec center multiple times a day and not taking in enough calories to maintain a healthy weight while they exercise. And all that ties into body image. And it's really, you know, I think it's hard to draw a fine line. I mean, I can think of some programs our HOCs or our staff over at the Women's Center are doing that focus specifically on one or the other. But at least, and for me, and I can own that some of this is my own personal experience as well, a lot of it is tied in, and you have to be willing to talk about all of it, because it goes into what overall it means to be a healthy adult. And I think that's a lot of what we do in terms of health and wellness programming to teach our college students, both our men and our women, is how to make healthy choices and be successful in the adult world. Does that answer your question, Jeff?
Yeah, absolutely.
Great.
And we have another one from Grace Fama. She wants to know, and it kind of touches on programming, from a programming standpoint, what ideas or what can we do to educate the students about body image and to help develop positive self-confidence?
Absolutely. One of the things we have here at Miami, and I haven't seen it at anywhere else, and I'm actually currently serving as their advisor, we have a group called IDEA, which actually stands for Individuals for Disordered Eating Awareness. And, you know, the acronym is IDEA, just like everything else on a college campus. It has a cute name. And even though their focus is disordered eating awareness, they do a ton of programming around body image. And next week they're actually doing an event called Love Your Body Week, and they do that every semester. So some of those things, and, you know, I'm so proud of the fact that it's a student organization and not like a faculty staff sponsored thing. It's something that came from students' ideas. A lot of what they do is awareness raising, and they'll stand in like our main academic quad area right outside of the entrance to one of our busiest kind of lunch dining options, and talk to students about what it means to love your body. And they do a Love Your Body Week pledge, and they get buttons or stickers that people can wear to say that they've pledged to love their body. And so I think those kind of programmings, just that kind of awareness building, has been working really good for my campus. You know, having positive conversations about body image, I think, is important. To think about the work that I do with the residence hall directors and the resident assistants that I kind of oversee in my job, making sure that they're not willing to shy away from things, I think, is being important. The word that's coming to mind right now is intrusive, but I know that's a little bit of a negatively connotated word. But, you know, if they're seeing the warning signs, that they are stepping up and having those conversations with residents. And last year I worked with one of my communities, and the focus of this community is actually kind of an athletic school spirit, history, athletics, traditions kind of thing. And they were struggling on their women's floor with some women who we believed were bulimic, which again I know is a little bit of a different realm than body image, but certainly those things are tied together. And they did some pretty in-your-face programming with that, you know, bringing in some folks from our counseling center who were well-versed in eating disorders and body image, and doing some, you know, passive things like bulletin boards and stuff in the bathrooms, and kind of, you know, we're not going to ignore this. We don't know exactly who's struggling right now, and you're not talking to us, but we're going to do those things to make sure that, you know we're here for you, and we want to help you, kind of in your face, which I thought was really good. And that was a first year residence hall with one floor of women, primarily athletes. So it was really interesting to kind of see what they were doing as intercollegiate athletes.
Yeah, and Mallory Emerson says that she thinks programming coming from peers can be more effective than messages sent from staff in terms of body image.
Oh, I think that for probably a lot of topics. I tell my RAs that all the time, that, you know, they're going to be able to send a message to their residents way better than I am, because I am out of touch. So I agree with you, Mallory.
Right. And I think one of the things go ahead, Jeff.
Oh, I was going to go to a different question, so go ahead, Gary.
I was just going to make a general comment. One of the sororities, when I worked at the University of New Mexico, one of the Latina sororities actually used to do like a Real Women Have Curves night. So they would do a screening of that film and then do an in-depth discussion with panelists afterwards about body image, and specifically in the Latina community, but as women in general as well.
That's really good, Gary. Real Women Have Curves, if people aren't familiar, is a movie starring America Ferrera from Ugly Betty, so a fairly popular Latina actress who, is known for her curves, I would say, and I own that movie myself, and I would say that's a great one for college women programming. I would give a plus up for Real Women Have Curves. Go ahead, Jeff.
We have a couple more questions here. One's more of a comment that it would be interesting to hear your comments on. So I think this topic is why I see homecoming king and queen contests so negatively.
Oh, wow, absolutely. I haven't thought about that in a while, actually. But one thing, I know Jeff and Gary are both fans of the show Greek, the ABC Family show. If you guys listen to their podcast, the Break Drink podcast, I've heard them talk about it more than once. And I think it was just over a week ago, they did a beauty pageant of some sorts as part of like their Greek Week blue ribbon points or whatever they were doing, which did make me think a little bit about body image and what, beauty pageants, and we could all talk, for another afternoon about that. I think a lot of campuses are still doing it. They will market it as not necessarily a beauty pageant. They'll base it on votes or on merit sometimes in terms of community service or fundraising done and things like that. But I think that's one of those things that, you're probably not going to get away from the fact that it is a popularity contest, and sometimes popularity is based on physical appearance. The good side of that is that certainly somebody that would involve themselves in something like that would probably feel pretty good about who they are, and hopefully that they are healthy and making good choices about what's going into their body and what they're doing to their bodies. So they're certainly not, I don't want to sound only negative about homecoming queens and homecoming kings and, whatever else it might be out there. But I think that, we work in college campuses. And a huge amount of what we do sometimes about the collegiate experience is those traditions. And sometimes you don't want to necessarily give up those traditions, but you need to think about if they're what's good for the university community as a whole. I think those are some of my initial thoughts. And if there's any past homecoming kings or homecoming queens out there, I support you and the work that you've done. I don't want to sound too negative on that one.
All right, and another question we have here is, eating disorders are one of the hardest issues for Res Life staff to deal with due to secrecy that goes on along with the purging behaviors. This is especially hard for male staff to confront in a sensitive and responsive way. Any ideas or advice on how to address eating disorders in the halls? For example, once staff have narrowed down who's purging, how best to confront?
Absolutely. The first tip I have for any, I would say, live-in or any residence life person in general is make friends with your housekeeper or whoever is cleaning the bathroom, because they're going to have an idea. First off, they have the biggest pulse on what's going on in your residence hall overall. Like, your housekeeper knows everything. And if I've had issues with a lot of my, not a lot, but several issues over the years of bulimic students, and you know, there's the vomiting and the purging that is associated with that. A lot of times it'll be your housekeeping or your maintenance staff who will be the first ones to notice, you know, vomiting in trash cans or in the toilet that might not be necessarily related to the other reasons why college students sometimes throw up. But they have a pulse on what's going on. So that's my number one tip. I think, you know, I'm thinking in my last position, I was in a live-in position. I was an area coordinator, and I had a woman in my area for 3 years who was admittedly bulimic. She would receive treatment over like the breaks when she was at home, but would refuse to go to any type of counseling or receive any treatment while she was on campus and going to classes and stuff like that. She would own her behavior and would say, "This is what I'm doing. I know it's not healthy for me, but this is the path that I'm on." So kind of, you know, reminded me of those women from the media that, you know, the pro-Mia kind of girls. We were pretty direct with her. And I would say this, you know, even thinking about mostly when I work with male residents and male residence halls, I say the direct approach is the best approach in terms of, okay, you're going to choose your own level of health right now. We acknowledge that this might not be the best choice for you, but this is your choice. As an adult, we're going to let you make this choice. But here's what we're going to need from you as the residence hall staff. And that had to do with the fact, you know, she wasn't going to, this particular resident had issues of keeping bags of vomit in her room, and it was causing a smell issue and things like that. So we talked about those kind of things. My institution could not mandate counseling. That was not something that was within our purview. So I would have loved to have gotten her into somewhere, but then, you know, counseling isn't always good if you aren't willing to talk it out or whatever you want to do. But I would say the direct approach. I think with men's floors, you struggle a little bit more with some of the passive programming that I've seen work on women's floors, like, I'll be lucky if I have a men's bulletin board stay up for a week in one of my buildings. So bulletin boards and those kind of things don't work necessarily as well. A lot of campuses, I've seen, if people are familiar with the MARS organization, which I don't know what the MARS acronym stands for, but a lot of the work that those organizations will do is around responsible sexual behavior with men. Sometimes, depending on the focus and if your institution has something like that, those groups can do some good stuff around other men's issues, in, whether that be eating disorders or body image. So I would say, you know, going back to what we talked about a few minutes ago, that they learn from their peers. And sometimes it's better to bring in a group of peers just to kind of have, you know, what I call a fireside chat, just to kind of talk it out a little bit, because this is coming from somewhere. And what can folks do to help anybody who might be struggling? What can folks do to kind of talk it through with their peers and kind of at least help be part of the solution as opposed to part of the problem? So I would say, you know, the direct approach, it, for most things, works better with my experience with men's floors and men's residence halls.
Great. And, Jamie, I think that's all the questions we have at this point right now.
Okay. Well, again, I'd like to thank everybody for taking time out of your Tuesday morning / afternoon to talk a little bit about body image and both men and women as the conversation directed itself. I really appreciated this opportunity, Jeff and Gary, so thanks for giving me that chance to talk a little bit about the work that I've done, and I wish you the best of luck with the rest of your Breakthrough Conference.
Absolutely. And, Jamie, if people have follow-up questions, is there a way they could get in touch with you?
Absolutely. They can email me. My name is Jamie Workman, Miami University Residence Life. My email is workmaj2, so it's workmaj2 at miamiuniversityohio.edu. So they can certainly email me or get in touch with Jeff and Gary on the BreakDrink website, and they can certainly direct questions my way. And I'd be happy to send out the presentation or any of the other minimal research I've done to kind of help folks out, especially if they have a residential focus.
Great. Thank you so much, Jamie.
Thank you. Jamie.